Okay, well, you want to ask your questions?
All right, yeah, so let's roll tape, clap, get going. So Alex, listen, it's great to be with you. We're going to keep this fun and informal, but what we're going to try to do over the next little bit is talk about the macro world, what the heck's happening across the world, and the micro, what the heck's happening at Palantir. You and I met, I don't know, about 10 years ago, 11 years ago. I was a has-been government economist, leaving government, starting to work with our mutual friend, Stan Druckenmiller. And you looked exactly like you do right now. And I looked like I did back then with my jacket and tie. And for some reason, we've become pals over these years. So what I want to try to do is not waste a whole lot of time on the past, but spend a lot of time on where we are and where we go from here. So if that sounds like a plan, let's get started. I'd say the first thing that strikes me, Alex, is you kind of always knew the world was a mess. From the time I met you, you knew the world was screwed up. And I would say over the period of the last 10 or 11 years, that's become increasingly known to citizens around the world. What gave you that sense that things weren't placid? Why is the world now more apparent to the world you had long seen?
That's a really hard question to answer because there are really two parts. It's like, well, why would an individual be more sensitive to dysfunction than another individual? And then two, why is that dysfunction in the present more apparent to the broader populace? Question one's very hard to answer. I do think there are, if you build a business that is quote unquote disruptive, meaning you create something that would not have existed but for you and a team of people, and the software is kind of a team sport, building it, and that thing, in our case, product, disrupts and redefines how people think and work and play and live their lives. You have to have a view of what is going to exist in the future and work back from that in the present, and then iterate with a subset of a market that doesn't exist to build a product that then becomes real. And that was how we built our first product, which was built on the idea that the instruments of anti-terror, actually the kinetic instruments, as valuable as they might be, were less valuable than this resource that people thought was valueless, data. And that using data would also bring with it ethical problems, which is kind of a more technical version of civil liberties and data protection. So that we did this many times. And then there's the individual reasons why I and maybe our founding team were more sensitive to those kind of dislocations. I think some of that's autobiographical, but some of it, I think, is just predisposition. Also, the closer you are to what you could call, in narrow terms, outsider, but maybe in more vulgar terms, the closer you are to being viewed as nuts, batshit crazy, or barely acceptable for common discourse, with the exception of people like you who, took interest, and in other cases, maybe mercy, or maybe were just curious and talking to forms of life that may have landed from another planet. But somehow having a different view of what reality means, I do personally think that was very much linked to dyslexia and autobiographical not fitting in. But then, so that's a hard thing. It's always hard. It's like an anthropological question: what makes you you, and why is it differentiated? So that, don't have a fully formed answer on that. And actually, it's always more interesting to talk to people you've known over the years who view you more objectively and ask them. And I'd be very interested in your views of this. And I'll fix the second half of the question, and then that might be interesting to hear why you think that is, since you are. Saw us at inception, saw us grow, saw all the skepticism around us, and then saw the Phoenix rise. Then on why is it that kind of normal, not, you know, I've landed from Mars, but, you know, citizenry is more aware of dislocations, disjunction, and broadly speaking, lack of what you might call alpha as defined by very little relations between input and output. And I think that's quite frankly because of just the onslaught of empirical experience. There's a fancy intellectual term, life world, which is a basically a way of explaining the culture as you confront it, but just also like the, you know, the attributes in the culture. And I think, you know, people see that basic infrastructure and, you know, whether it's in the core parts of our society, which essentially involve socialization, foreign policy, dealing with emergencies, pandemics, wars, terror events, that there's a rise of simplistic solutions, and even they don't seem to work. And coupled and that with a dramatic rise of successful innovation, especially in the US. So I don't think people would actually be as cynical about dysfunction if parts of the economy were also performing as poorly. So in the US especially, you have just very interesting, very disruptive, very effective companies that are so effective that at some point companies struggle to compete with them, that create these enormous positive and you could argue sometimes negative attributes, but certainly from a wealth creation perspective, more your area of expertise than mine. It just anomalously interesting, creative. And then the contrast, I think a lot of it's the contrast. It's like, well, and then how would you describe execution against this public policy issue? And it doesn't look acceptable. And so I think that creates a lot of disjunction in America. Then you also have a sense where that we're kind of, you know, this famous quote, the center isn't holding. And whether the center isn't holding culturally, educationally, from foreign policy perspective, relationships with friends and adversaries are somehow not, people say strained, but strained assumes that they're tethered. There's a feeling that they're untethered rather than strained. And so I think that there's a whole set of software issues involved in that, which we believe we're heavily involved, but that I think those are the, yeah.
So let me, I'll give you my take on both these and you guys should feel free to edit this away. When I met you, I didn't think you were as strange or different as you thought you were. And I remember once you said to me, that's because you only hang out with strange people. But I thought your attitude, your instincts were genuine. That was who you how you perceived yourself. The other thing that I thought is I thought you were properly naive. Like if you had realized in 2009, 10, 11, how hard this was going to be, I don't know whether you could have mustered the will to build this incredible team to take this on, to be so radical in the sort of product solution, software, et cetera. And so the other thing that I will say attracted me is there was a, I see the world differently perspective, which is what you had then. And frankly, I think what you still have, the world is coming to you. The world now sees the dysfunction that you referenced. And there was a certain, you know, what do they say? The reason we send 18-year-olds to war is they don't know any better. We wait until they were 28, you know, then they'd turn and run away from the enemy. You had enough of that. So it's sort of being both jaded and innocent. I think that was pretty darn important. So that's my cycle babble on you. On the broad moment, I would say, I'd put it this way, and here I'm gonna sound like a boring macroeconomist. The 21st century has been super unkind. Three major shocks, 9/11, the global financial crisis, where I've still got the scars, and now COVID. And what our governments have done around the world, what the G20 have done is sort of tried to plaster those over, try to make those go away. And there's been a veneer of everything is just swell. And again, my crazy view is the veneer has been led by the world's central banks, who pushed up financial asset prices, said everything's going to be just fine. But that veneer is what's not holding. It's sort of the language you used about the center not holding. That veneer now looks like a veneer. And what we're in the process of seeing in the US and all the countries where you do business is there are real tensions just below the surface. So I think that's what I want to explore with you. I think that's why the world looks very unsettled, because it is. And the veneers that we've used to make the 21st century look just fine, that's disappearing quickly. So I guess my question, just to put it back to you, is in a benign world, Alex, you guys have done, in a seemingly benign world, you've been able to sell these products to people that weren't so sure that they wanted them or needed them. They thought they could buy little point solutions from others, have this little SaaS model. If we're right that we're at this hinge point, George Shultz called this before he passed, the hinge point in history. We're at that hinge point, and we're now in a world that will be obviously more unsettled. Does that play to the sweet spot of you and your management team and your company? Or have you guys grown accustomed to a seemingly benign period?
Well, again, I do like this riff on properly naive, and I do think that's super important in decision-making. And like in my life, like going to grad school, had I had any idea what it was like to really write a dissertation in technical German, I probably wouldn't have done it. When we co-founded Palantir, I was supposed to be something like interim CEO. And had I known I would be interim, non-interim CEO almost 2 decades later, I would have thought long and hard about that. Had I known that, you know, we would, you know, it would be very difficult to build new products, go into different jurisdictions. Also, the headwinds you have when you're doing something new and different, and also when you're not willing to simplify either politically, intellectually, or in a product form, what you're doing. You know, it's like the French Metro used to have these things like defamatory about Frankfurt, about Palantir in like every Metro stop. So it's like these things never really occurred to me, and they still exist. You know, as much as I would like to, so I'm saying I, but we would like to become more, maybe subconsciously, able to fit into normal structures. That's just not something that I believe we're differentiated at. And although the world has been with kind of episodic interventions more benign, maybe in the past, certainly in the past, than we believe it will be in the future, the not so secret of Palantir is an affirmation of our ability to do a narrow set of things, we believe, in a way that really no other company at our scale does them, and no other company seeks to do them, because it's still so far outside the norm. But it's an area where we feel comfortable. And that part of that, not all of it, but part of it is building software products around the assumption that the world will become more complicated, more disjoined, more unhinged, where legitimacy is more point specific and not global, and where the legitimacy of institutions has to be reasserted, recreated with a certain kind of facticity, because there's no ability to just say, well, look at the past and how well we were. You have to actually prove that there's output. And our software products, each the major ones that, you know, are known, PG, Foundry, but obviously the ones that are less known, the ones we're using with the special forces, both on the back end and the front end, products that we're building to deal with specifically disjointed environments that we haven't shipped yet, and building software for the edge are specifically built with the idea that tomorrow will be it'll be a step function in terms of complexity, where the step function, it will be accelerated because of disjunctions and lack of legitimacy of major institutions, and that other software products are built as if the world will be more static, more reliable, more certain, more able to deal with simplicity. Ergo, sales will be dominant, product complexity and innovation will be much less important than the sales and the way you pretend your products are, and that our sweet spot of doing this will become more and more valuable over time, more valuable tomorrow than it was yesterday. And that, by the way, has an important feedback loop, because it means we can keep the culture of Palantir the way we like the culture to be, i.e. one that sustains highly individual, often differentiated in the terms of their personality, people that are very, very focused on technical issues that most people, including most experts, do not believe exist. And so, like, we have this problem in our interaction with people that is very different than other companies, I think. The problem that other companies have, broadly speaking, is they have to convince people that they'll be able to build products that are relevant tomorrow. Which, by the way, is much harder than people seem to think, especially analysts have this weird idea that building software is like writing an analyst report, or lawyers think building software product is like handing in a brief. You can just hire one law firm to do it. If the other law firm, it's just factually completely not true. But the problem, so the normal company has is trying to convince people that they will build things that they're not going to build tomorrow, because it's not actually in their DNA. The problem Palantir has is convincing people that they need something that they will need tomorrow. And these are very, very different problems. And we're very focused as a company on this, delivering things we believe you will need tomorrow, building on our internal view of what we're good at and what we've shown we're good at, whether it was, you know, I went through the whole history or at least part of it, while then often figuring out ways to modulate the product so that people who want parts of the product that maybe are a little bit more refurbishing your 90s enterprise-like can also have refurbishment. But it's not, you know, refurbishment of your 90s IT architecture is certainly something you can use a modulated part of Palantir for, and it's a very important thing for kind of growth in certain parts. But our real differentiation is productive oddity.
So you used a word that I remember using a decade ago in your presence with Sham and KK and a whole bunch of others. And it was a dirty word back then, but you used it. And I think I've heard you use it recently, sales. And I remember I showed up in your office once. I was dressed like this. And I think you screamed at one of the guys. You said, Kevin's here. He looks like the guy from IBM. And I was talking about, well, you know, we need like really finance controls and, you know, how are you going to sell the product and all this stuff. But I would say you certainly built that as a public company. You built all those controls. Sales isn't a dirty word anymore, but somehow you grafted that on to the strange company that can produce these products. How's that transition been, if I've got it right?
Well, you know, you do, because you're differentiated and somewhat living in your own outside world, doesn't mean you can't learn from more normal people. Although I'm not including you in that normal person. I know you want to be included in that, but I honestly think you wouldn't be hanging out with us if you were as normal as you claim to be. But in any case, but you're very good at presenting yourself that way, and I'm very jealous of that. It's like the more we do this, so we have this for a long time, and like, you know, we've entered the government market and then we've entered this market, and there are many markets where, you know, we are the de facto product people buy, not all markets. What you see is in the beginning, I thought we were differentiated in building the software and getting people to adopt it. And I do think we are differentiated in building software, again, software that becomes more and more relevant over time, and getting people to adopt the software before, right before they inherently understand its full value. So that's essentially, in more vulgar terms, getting people to adopt something that they will understand tomorrow better than they understand today. I do not believe we are differentiated in getting people to understand something that they understood yesterday and need to understand better tomorrow. And that because we've been, in all candor, so successful at this one thing, and because in over two decades of doing this, we believe no one else does what we do, it's much easier to be open and like, okay, we do this, we don't do this. And there are people who are very, very good at some of the stuff we don't do, like conventional sales. So, you know, my essential pushback on sales was like my pushback on going public for a long time. It was like, how do you do this while maintaining our culture? My version of that was you couldn't do that. We didn't know how to do that in the 10 years ago, 18 years ago. But it seems like the thing we do has become more recognizably valuable. And that allows us, that gives us a wider range of motion to also partner with people that do things but the key is, how do you do it without corrupting the internal culture that must stay reminiscent of the way it was in the beginning and rejuvenated to deal with new problems? That is a culture of product innovation and complexity.
Let's see. I want to keep bouncing back. Maybe it's working for your partners who are listening, and maybe it's not, between the company and the macro. So you talked about how the world is messy. We both talked about it. The world is starting to look as messy as you've been talking about since I've known you. Traditional borders in question, the great power competition between the US and China, more apparent, harder to hide from. The overwhelming free liquidity that the world's central banks have provided, now showing that there are consequences, second order consequences to that. Does this, if I'm half right, that 12 months from now, it'll be harder to hide from the stark new reality of this, what do we call this, the post-war order? What's that mean for the company? First, do you agree that that's where the direction we're going? And if so, what do you do about that as the leader of this company? You just let the world continue to move towards you, or do you have to do something different?
Well, there are a lot of questions in your question. Broadly speaking, we're in agreement about where you believe the world is heading. I believe that's roughly right, with the caveat that because of the dearth of legitimacy and general feeling of unhingedness, in German you could say Unbehagen, which is like something like malaise, but deeper. I think there could be radically accelerating events. So it's like, I always think these things, it's hard to have, like, I think it could be like on a progression where it goes like that, which is probably a little bit too much taken from the way it is when you like build a software product. It's like this and then like that, or like this and like that, but it's rarely just like this. But in any case, we are definitely of kindred spirits on that. There are two pieces. What do we do as a company? Well, there's some things we're going to continue doing that we've always done. I would say, the software products you would need to deal with a dislocated world would have to be able to manage data in jurisdictions which are no longer connected, maintain software products, a myriad of them in your enterprise, where you are dealing with jurisdictions that are, again, disconnected, where there's a low trust environment, so you couldn't just ship the updates, you'd have to have them be verified, where the physical infrastructure you're relying on changes daily, breaks, where you would need to be able to create digital replicas of what you're doing because the complexity of the changes are just much greater than what you expected, where your underlying software that you've been relying on basically provides no alpha because it's not actually built for that world, and where you have internal workforce and political issues that also just make your daily issues much harder and mean that you have to be able to understand where you are as a company along the production and sales and regulatory and all these things that involve running a complex company that's now being kind of in the middle of glacial shifts. So those are things that we've been working on for the last, call it, since inception, and are built into our products. And now, where we're going to be doing a lot, we've begun doing it last year, and where is how, if you work back from the assumption, our assumption, maybe there are skeptics, but it is our belief that we have a set of products that are underappreciated because the macro conditions have not arrived for their full value to be appreciated. Although very valued in many contexts, so vaccine distribution and manufacturing and biomedical research and myriad of preventive maintenance, all sorts of things that are well known at this point. But how do we figure out ways to get institutions to both adopt and disseminate the product, but also the knowledge of how you actually deal with these problems? Institutions that are not always Palantir. And so we've been on a journey to identify startups in between, could call it half grown up companies, whether it's in the context of, you know, people building their company. We have Founders for Builders. We've invested in a lot of companies. We're going to continue to search for partners that can distribute not just our software, but knowledge of what it means when things are just dislocating. And how would you use software to do that? Now, you could say, well, that's obvious, but actually, this is a completely new world. There really are very few experts for what does it mean to do product maintenance when you no longer have access to your core data stack, and when the assets are kind of at the edge of your enterprise and not at the center. What does it mean if you can no longer ship software to a jurisdiction? What does it mean if countries are in the middle of a near kinetic war for your supply chain? How do you get a supply chain to work if certain parts of it shut down? There's the software element where we know we have the right software products. There's the knowledge element, like how does a third party who's never really dealt with that challenge have a credible interaction with individuals that understand how to do that and then are opting for the best products on the market, which in this case will be ours.
Yeah. You, I mean, you said that German word for malaise. I couldn't say that word. But the crazy thing, just to pile on to what you said, the crazy thing is, in the U.S. at least, we've got full employment, nominal wages are moving higher, the stock market is near its career highs. Everything should be swell. The American people should, at some level, be so thrilled with how things are. This should feel like a great economic boom. But at some level, they sound like you. If you look at surveys of the administration, of government, of institutions, you know, you wouldn't know that the surveys make it sound like the 1970s. According to surveys, 70% of the American people think the country's on the wrong track. 75% don't have trust in institutions. The similar numbers think that their kids are going to be worse, less well off than they are. So the last time we felt this kind of malaise, at least in the U.S., this was the Carter era. Malaise, decay, the end of the American dream. And the question is, what happens next? So it's a funny moment to a nerdy economist like me. It's a funny moment that the world in the America particularly is stuck in this malaise when the objective factors say they shouldn't. And again, this might show why I'm a small C conservative. Because there's an underlying wisdom and common sense that you know, the Harvard faculty might not have, but the first 200 people in the Boston.
Well, let me just take the although I mean, I view myself as a maybe intellectual progressive, certainly maybe of a 70s pedigree. And I believe that it's like it is in the interest of institutions to be functional, and that functioning institutions is a progressive form of common sense. But I do think you have this, again, problem in America that it's like in some parts of our economy, some parts of America are the best functioning in the world by far. As an example, enterprise software. It is a fact that America, arguably only parts of America, but certainly as a country, produce a level of quality company and products, and purely measured on vulgar market cap, which is wouldn't be my exact way of measuring, but is a measure, that is completely differentiated from any other part of the world. And it's interesting, like the second most interesting place in the world for what the kind of things that kind of Palantir does is Israel. That's a tiny country. It's like, so, you know, you have like, I spent a lot of my life in Europe. I speak German. I do things in French.
What things do you do in French?
Mostly work, to your surprise, but we power a lot of important institutions in France. I'm very proud of that, actually. And then we're supporting founders in French, in France, and you can see videos of me in French if that would be interesting to you. It's just part of the problem, I think, is a dissonance. So I think this actually could be worse than in the 70s, because you have this contrast of, like, you know, wealth creation as a reflection of enormous output that is exceedingly differentiated, done by very creative, out of the norm, often people building companies that otherwise should not exist and having massive success in a way that you don't find, or I'm not aware of, in any other country in the world. Again, in my space, our space, enterprise software, but also broadly defined. And that contrasted with things that are not working as well is a problem, but of enormous consequence. And then I think some of the things you're talking about, where it's just like, and then the conflicts that exist externally to the US can no longer be papered over. So it's just, I think it's gonna be a very, unfortunately, exceedingly interesting time the next 10 years.
This is my last shot at the philosophy, which you can do better than I. So again, you know, the way you described it, I put it in slightly different language, and I want your take on it. So the only thing that's working are what Edmund Burke used to call the little platoons that create incredible enterprises, create incredible communities, incredible groups of people that can work together. The little platoons are still working. He described them as the community, the family, the sort of working association. What's not working are things that are the big platoons, institutions in our governments, public utilities that are, you know, were once entrepreneurial companies that are now more like the electric and gas company. So it's little platoons.
Well, roughly. So I do think there's some big, like, for example, there are parts of our DOD, clandestine services, special forces, that don't get the public accolades they deserve, for very obvious reasons, because they're built not to get them, that have produced enormous and largely unknown results. You see this also not just in America, but in Europe, in the intel space, where I know I'm aware of numerous terror attacks, that have massive ones that have been stopped, that would have led to a completely different political landscape in Europe. There are efforts that show results, and where I think, for example, Americans and Europeans and others would be very proud, but unfortunately, many of them are unknown. I do think, for example, Americans have a healthy and deserved regard for the U.S. Armed forces, and it shows up in the polling. But to your point, What is anomalous is the things that have started off as micro initiatives or companies end up being so disproportionately able to grow and produce alpha that they're overshadowing other institutions that have to reform. But at Palantir, I do believe in, like, reformation is the wrong word, obviously, but I believe in that too. But reform, and I think one of the things that's very special about the US market, so commercial market especially, is it's the most adaptive market in the world. And so, and that's why people who are kind of more outside the norm can succeed, even though we can't really be part of the norm that we're helping to succeed. And so, I think some of the larger institutions in America will reform, but in part because the pressure that we smaller institutions that are growing rapidly put them under, and that without these kind of micro juggernauts that become juggernauts, and the adaptation abilities, especially in the U.S., you would have a super, then you can't cope with the future. Now, where I kind of agree with your more, I want to say, skeptical take is that we are not prepared for the world we're going into, and that the adaption, the iterative circles are going to have to be much quicker because, in fact, there's an acceleration of dislocation. And that is something that our large and even smaller institutions are—they're coping with the current problem, which they may or may not be coping with. But tomorrow's set of problems is going to be a completely different kettle of fish.
Let's take that and dig. So I share that we've got to begin fundamental reform of these institutions instead of just throwing more money at it and pretending that this liquidity surge is going to let these institutions.
Well, by the way, we are differentiated slightly politically. I'm okay with money. I just like the money. I want to see where the money goes. Yeah. So we shouldn't, for all of our similarities and affinities, I still think I'm actually progressive and I think you're a moderate, conservative.
So I want to dig down into the companies. I want to dig down into the commercial business of yours, and if you're going to let me, a little bit on the military national security side. I think where we agree on the financial piece of it is there's going to be a bill to pay. There are no free lunches, and the more direct we can get the money to those that deserve it, the better off we'd be. But let's dig into the business. So on your commercial business, I'm going to take a shot at your competitors for a minute. So, or your would-be competitors. Some of them have a lot of nice products. It strikes me as the non-technologist, their products are narrower than yours, maybe more easily digestible, certainly more easily saleable. How do you think about, the Snowflakes of the world, the Databricks of the world, and that product suite, as it were, compared to yours?
Well, that's both a shot at them and a could be a legitimate critical, interesting question about Palantir. Our products are deeper than any other products on the market, have an institutional veracity that's differentiated, are doing things that are arguably more important. I don't think that's really subject to debate. I do think what is a legitimate question is, if a product is future oriented and requires a depth of understanding of the product, and or it doesn't inherently map to selling a wrench to a pre-existing technical org, will you capture the full value of those products? So I think you can ask the critical question of various companies. You mentioned two, there are many. Are the products actually thick enough to be valuable? You could ask the question of Palantir, is it thin enough to be fully monetized? And I think both questions are legitimate. What I would say is our view at Palantir is we're we're very differentiated in building these products before they exist. On the thick part, we are without competition. So then there's a question of, are we able to supply parts of our product or various products, for example, products that we're building now, products that we have in Foundry, to an enterprise that may in fact prefer something that fits into their architecture that is thinner? That gets into a very legitimate question, which is, okay, forget now. It's like, is Palantir building the product of the future, but willing to supply into the current environment by providing products that are more digestible into an organization that maybe it wants to go their own way and wants to buy a certain product for a certain thing, but does not want to buy all of Foundry. By the way, and so the answer in the near term has been yes, but in the future, we are going to continue to focus very much on what you're calling kind of thick, future-oriented products because they're differentiated. But then as the parts of this product become less differentiated and more, for lack of a better word, commodity, like there's 8 companies that supply them, figuring out ways to decouple the product and sell these things in a modular way, partly because there's an assumption which is just not true that is very intuitive, that if you have a full stack product, that the sums of the product are less valuable than if they were taken apart, i.e. that each wrench, each part of that product is inferior to a product that's just that product. But it's actually not true at all. It's actually the opposite. And part of what we will be doing over the next couple of years is both continuing to build things that are not understood, sell them to deal with the macro conditions that you have outlined that I agree, but also democratizing parts of our product so that people who want a different version of the product can also buy it. We're not super ideological there, as long as our core mission is to continue to be entrepreneurial outsiders in the product realm, which is where, again, we would like to continue to stay in a world where we're not competitive.
Yeah, I mean, if I've got this right, if you could disaggregate the solution into various products and you could make one product thin enough, you could just slip it under the door, then the guy who's got to buy it on the other side might say, yeah, that works pretty well. And then you're in the enterprise versus just banging on the door and saying, really, this
well,
is
the our version of that is, first of all, the larger product is particularly valuable where dislocation happens and your institution will die. So there's going to just be an increased demand for that. But, we are in the business of building software. And if you want, and then now we're going to figure out in the future, how do you also disambiguate the products in a way that people who just want to buy parts of it can buy? And that's never been a contradiction for us. Honestly, every successful business that ends up being massively, massively successful, and not Palantir today, but Palantir in 5 years, what we will be, it starts with the world's most complex problem, figures out solutions for it, and then figures out a way to do that tomorrow and the next day while allowing people to buy parts of it that are arguably less complex. And that's how you build not a business that is where we are now, but a business that is 10 times, arguably 20 times bigger.
It's exciting. And listen, I'd rather come at it, in a world that is at this hinge point, I'd rather come at it and now need to disaggregate the products than to say, okay, now we're going to build a solution.
Well,
for our company.
The thing that's not understood about software is that it is building a, this is why, I mean, again, without, these are, they're, America produces some of the most interesting, creative, and valuable software, enterprise software companies in the world. And even in America, people do not understand it's nearly impossible to build software products. So normal companies just buy them. Why do they, nothing wrong with that, but why do you buy a software product? Because it's nearly impossible to build a new one. And you need to be a very specialized company. Most of these very specialized companies that do it have 10 people. We have 2,500 people. And Foundry has 400 products in it. Apollo is a completely revolutionary way of supplying, maintaining software products. Edge AI products that are coming on the market, completely not understood. The way in which we deal with AI and ML, completely unique. The anti-terror products that are not part of the public view are completely unique and differentiated. And these, this is a company that has 2,600 people that is still producing world-class product. And that's just something that is non-existent in the world. And that there's no, that's not a critique of other companies. They have a different solution by companies. And that, nothing wrong with that. But that is a, you have to have a very different approach if you're attacking the market, if you can build products, than if you can't.
How I want to follow up with this, then I want to come back to the last real subject for you, which is the national security military.
We're on an hour clock.
I know, I got 8 minutes. I'm gonna
get 8 minutes.
So you just said something which, you know, I will say makes sense to me, has always made sense. You know, you and your management team, you've got backgrounds in technology and philosophy and understanding, but at core, you guys are all actually just in the HR business. At some level, all you are is trying to recruit the best talent on the planet and then build a culture so they can do the most incredible things. And if I've got that right or somewhat right, tell me about what that's like today in the world versus 4, 5, 6 years.
By the way, it's recruit, retain, and lead without the people feeling like you're a dictator. So there is a leadership part. It's just very different. So to begin to answer your question, the way people think, so like world-class engineers, attracting world-class engineers, retaining them while also inspiring them maybe to think differently about how they would build a product. If you build a product for engineers, you have a very interesting product that no one buys, i.e. where buying is a metaphor for worldly impact. So the recruitment and retention is a cultural plus, in our case, track record of doing this, which is, you know, unique in the world, basically, in my view, and in the view of the people that come. I mean, it's commonly known fact that Palantir gets among, if not the best software engineers in the world, and we've been doing this for a long time, and we're still getting the very best in the world. So, but then there's that, but there's also, you know, if you want, you know, Foundry to be built, or PG to be built, or Apollo to be built, or you want to modulate these products so that you can sell them in different ways, you have a high convincing, it's not conviction, but high convincing culture, meaning you're going to have to convince people that are basically not fireable because they know they're the best in the world. And they also know, unlike most people who evaluate software, that the ability to build a product is maximally unfair in the sense that really only a couple of people in the world can build the kind of products we have. And so you have to convince them, cajole them, get inside their thought process to build the product that's not just the one that they might want to build, but one that will actually disrupt the world. And that is a very unique and very hard thing, very time consuming, requires a lot of characteristics, some of which you don't really understand why they work, but de facto we have a culture and people who've done this over and over again. But as an example, the biggest products we've built, I've personally interacted with the person who's built them extremely regularly, because it's like you have, and it's not a hardware problem. See, in hardware, by and large, or in other things, or you say you have a law firm and somebody doesn't want to write the memorandum the way you want it. Well, great, they can go to another law firm. And arguably, the lawyer who shows up the next day is even better. That is not the way it works in software. If your person who can build X product leaves, that product will stall or die. But then if you just leave it to them building it, you will get a product that is interesting, that has a total addressable market of 10 people. And so when you're asking about macro conditions and us agreeing, it's how do you get the macro conditions that no longer exist into an engineer's brain so that you get the product you need while interacting with a client or a subset of clients to make sure the clients actually can use it, and also to make sure the software actually creates alpha for those institutions. Yeah. And that is an iterative set of skills, but more, it's, you could almost call them very productive creative habits that are super rare and mostly found in America for very complicated reasons that are hard for us actually to understand, but that Palantir has indigenously and that we plan to keep.
Yeah. I mean, the last piece of that to attract, retain, help lead those people is ultimately what you're building and doing has got to matter. It's got to matter. And I think what Palantir's always had is the goal is to matter. And maybe one of the places where Palantir's mattered most are inside war-torn places, inside places where national security is paramount. And so, gosh, what you've done and built in places like, dare I say it, Afghanistan over the course of the last year, which has become apparent, it sure mattered. Can you pull back the curtain a little bit and give us a sense of how it's mattered and why it's mattered there?
Well, you know, when there's radical disjunction, so you have to repurpose your system, say as a complete matter of theory, you decided to change your policy in a country and that was not, you know, modeled into your systems, that was not the way in which you were planning to execute. It's really no different than a supply chain disjunction, like all of a sudden you have to ship something across five countries through containers. It's like, getting people to leave a country when in fact that may not have been exactly the way one was thinking of it overnight requires a software product that can work overnight on data sets where it previously may not have had access. But this is actually, from a technical perspective, no different than how do you unify the country of England so that you can, that is made up of 600 hospital systems that are not unified, or a country called the United States so that people can get their vaccine and their PPE, or how do you all across Europe find terrorists while dealing with the most intricate, complicated, and but for Europeans and for me also sensible data protection rules, how do you monitor things at the edge when your compute capacities are limited? These are things that where again it's the disjunction that causes the water to pull back and the nakedness of the enterprise to be apparent. And in that full nakedness, you will see that whether your software products work or don't.
Yeah, fewer people I know and fewer companies that I know have done more things in and around crises in the last 12, 24, 36 months than you and your colleagues. And frankly, gotten less credit for it. If anything, maybe gotten slings and arrows for it. But if the world is at that place we talked about at the outset of this 50 minutes ago, at that hinge point, and we're...
Well, you know, slings and arrows are interesting. Like, you know, we get attacked in Europe. We get attacked in Europe for like, you know, I don't know, data platform financed by the CIA. It's like a small investment almost 20 years ago. But one of the things I would say is you get the slings and arrows because if the terror attacks had happened that our software with the help of people using it stopped, you would not have the slings and arrows actually. If the slings and arrows often because the situation is good enough, you can hate us. And we helped make the situation good enough, you can hate us. And you know, it's like, maybe that's the price to pay for what many of the things our software does, but it is an interesting thing that many of the slings and arrows are only the result of a situation that's good enough so you can, you know, go try to attack the reason why it was reasonably good.
Well, Alex, listen, this isn't the end of the story, but it is the end of our podcast. And, you know, listen, my instinct, having been around you and your team for a long time, is usually when companies get to this level of success and have gone through this and emerged as the Phoenix, there's some degree of complacency, some degree of, well, you know, that was great. And I think this thing that I see in you and your guys is there's none of that. And if anything, the next 5 years actually are more promising than the last five. Let's end it there, Alex, but I'm glad we got a chance to do it. We'll look forward to our next episode of this little podcast.
Me too. Thank you.
Thanks, pal.
Talk to you soon. Bye.